Good evening. My name is Ann Berman, as chair of the Environmental Concerns Coalition, or better known as the ECC. I would like to welcome all of you for coming and attending this debate, and especially of our four candidates during their very busy schedule. Okay. Danielle, it's your.
Good evening, everybody, and good evening to all the candidates. Again, thank you all for coming, and thanks to Ann Berman for putting this event on. Just by way of ground rules, they're pretty basic. There's going to be four questions that I'm going to ask. The candidates will have 2 minutes to respond initially, and then they'll each have a minute for rebuttal. Then for our fifth question, as it were, we're going to have them pick a question out of the hat, and the same ground rules will apply. And then at the end, we'll open the debate up to questions and answers from the floor. So the first question is directed to Ms. Salvatore, and we're just going to go right down the line. What qualities do you have that would make you capable of inspiring people in Milford to take better care of the environment?
Thank you. Well, thank you all for being here tonight. Thank you to the ECC for having this forum. You know, we had a mayoral debate a few weeks ago at the Plymouth Men's Club. And that was a wonderful opportunity for all of you to ask us the questions that are on your mind. And it gave us a real opportunity to listen. You know, a lot of us, we mayoral candidates and we politicians generally, we talk, and we talk a lot. So I welcome this opportunity. So we're talking, but we're talking in response to your questions. And I thank you for that. I'm a passionate advocate for the environment. I can be a responsible environmental steward, and I can provide the leadership that Milford needs for a greener future. I have a long history with care and concern about environmental issues. From my early days as a Girl Scout, I cleaned the shoreline, picking up trash, cleaning the debris, and working on restoring dunes. For my wedding, my husband and I gave away evergreen saplings as our wedding favors, with a message to all of our guests to care for the tree, to care for the environment, as we care for each other. As an adult, I have an organic garden today that I maintain with my family and with my son. It's an organic vegetable garden. We take great pride in that garden. And what we can't build, what we can't grow in our garden, we purchase locally. Robert Treat Farm is one of our favorite places to obtain locally grown and produced produce. So we try to be good environmental stewards in all of our family life and all of my professional life. I recycle in my office. I buy recycled paper. My commitment to being an environmentally friendly citizen, again, extends to all facets of my life. And there's something important I want to address tonight. I am a citizen of this community as much as any of you are. Now, some of you may have heard through the grapevine or through the Republican convention that I have a home in Nantucket. And I'm very proud of that home, but there's an interesting story, and I want to tell you very quickly about the cottage we have in Nantucket. When we bought that cottage, on the property was a rundown 1970s ranch. It would be subject to our blight ordinance that we have today. It had been cared for in many years. So we decided that it was necessary for the safety of everyone to have that house removed. But what we did, we tried to be good citizens. Rather than tearing the house down and simply putting it in the dumpster and putting it in the landfill, we posted on that community's local bulletin board. And we said to everyone in the community, come and take what you can. Take and reuse and repurpose whatever you can from that house. And people took everything. They took the floorboards, they took the tiles, they took the bricks from the deck. That's an example of how I can be a leader for the community here in Milford, how I can lead us forward by being a community, by sharing, by reusing, reducing, and recycling. I will address that more, and I guess our 2 minutes go a lot quicker than I thought they would tonight. So again, I welcome you, I thank you, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Again, thank you all for coming tonight. The question was about qualities that would make you a good environmentalist and an environmentalist. I think the qualities would be sincerity and dedication. Now, forgive me for reading, but I don't want to leave anything out, so I'm going to have to read a little bit. I'm a Milford bird watcher, fisherman, boater, and hiker, and I have been these things my entire adult life. These hobbies alone do not qualify me to be the mayor of Milford, but these interests have inspired me to become active in Milford government at times in my adult life and to become an activist citizen at other times in my adult life. My interest in birds and fish broadened to an interest in the interrelationships of all living things. That is what an ecologist is. I consider myself an ecologist. What good is it to know the wood duck if you don't know about inland wetlands? We used to call them swamps in the old days, and the tree cavities, sycamores, that wood ducks nest in. There's a picture of a wood duck I brought tonight. Already 1 minute? Wow, I gotta move. What good is it to know about bluefish without knowing that they feed on the menhaden or the moss bunker, and that they're subject to these periodic die-offs, especially in the southwestern part of Long Island Sound, especially late in the summer when the waters get warm. Government service should not be a career. Mayor Baldwin appointed me to the Conservation Commission in the late 1970s when I saw that Milford seemed casual about filling in the tidal marshes as well as the inland marshes. At the second meeting, I was appointed chairman along with Letty Martillon Malone, and we spoke at numerous public hearings to save those inland wetlands and those tidal wetlands for the wood ducks, for the bluefish, and others. Later, I became alarmed at the size of housing projects in town, knowing that every new home represented additional cars on our streets, energy consumption, and garbage in our waste stream. I decided to run for the Planning and Zoning Board. I won several terms on that board, and recently I and others spoke out against a large apartment complex on Prospect Street. Again, the more people we have in town, the more traffic on the streets, the more in our waste, garbage waste stream. All right, you'll have to hear more later.
We do talk a lot, and for me just to ramble on, I'm going to try to stay to a script and tell you, to answer the question. And the question was, what qualities do we have that will make us capable of inspiring the people in Milford? Well, as I was sitting at my desk thinking about how I have inspired people in both my corporate life and within the numerous local organizations I have led, it dawned on me that this question really misses the central point of the Milford environmental issue somewhat. For I believe that you cannot possibly judge the next mayor on his or her qualities that inspire residents to make more environmental responsible. That simply passes the buck from the mayor to the residents, and it has a possibility of being transient. As mayor, I will do more than inspire by ensuring and sustaining greater environment responsibility in two fundamental ways. The first way is to lead by example. Simply inspiring means that the mayor cannot talk the talk without walking the walk. All the inspiration in the world will fail if you don't have proper leadership. As mayor, I will ensure that our carbon footprint shrinks immediately 1 minute by doing the following more. I will replace city gas guzzlers. I will adopt the leadership in energy environmental design. I will ensure all of our buildings are energy efficient. I will explore deliberately the use of alternative energy, and I will reduce waste within our city governments. The second way of ensuring greater environmental consciousness is simplification. To my point, let some leadership by example when it comes to saving our environment, and let's make it easy and cost effective for our neighbors to follow. 30 seconds. Thank you.
Nice talking.
Good evening, everyone. It's really an honor and it's a pleasure to be here tonight. And I'm so delighted to see so many people, especially our young people who are here this evening. I want to thank the ECC for sponsoring tonight's event and for making me a better leader and a better mayor in our community, especially when it comes to environmental issues, those things that are so important to our community. Being a community on Long Island Sound, we have a special responsibility to take care of the environment. We need to take care of our air, our water, our natural resources, and throughout the past 8 years, I have done that. To address the opening question quite simply, I can inspire others to care for our environment because as your mayor for the past 8 years, I have built a proven record of thoughtful management and real leadership in this area with the help of so many of you. I look around the room and see so many of you that have helped me and help our citizens become a leader in the state of Connecticut for environmental issues. It began with our fight against the Sooty Six. And that's when I met many of you. Our fight up at the State House with Joyce Acebo Raguskas on dealing with diesel in the school buses, chemical pesticides in our schools and fighting that, doing things with recycling, innovative things like buying one of the few communities in our state who purchased an asphalt recycler, So now we take all of our asphalt that's ground up and built up, and we recycle it, and we put it back onto our roads. Open space, our record is long. We started with the Solomon property. Mayor Lisman was instrumental in that, and we closed the day that I became mayor on the Solomon property, and that set the stage for Wampus Lane and the Stowe Farm and the Guide property, the Novelli-Rotman orchards, the Burnt Plains Road property, and other very significant open space properties. Responsible clean water projects. We, as I said before, being on Long Island Sound and having two major rivers, three rivers that run through our community, we have to make sure that we take care of our waterways, and that means investing in our infrastructure. And I know I'm out of time. There are a lot more that we'll talk about throughout the night. Thank you.
All right, thank you for those introductions. The first question, which again Ms. Salvatore will answer first, is this. Three of our sister municipalities, Orin, Woodbridge, and Bethany, have joined together to become green cities. Regardless of what they mean by green cities, if you wanted to make Milford a green city during your tenure as mayor, what would you mean by this term?
Thank you. Now I know to talk fast. Being a green city means of being a good global citizen. As your mayor, I'm going to blaze a new trail that leads us on the path to a greener, more environmentally healthy future for Milford. We're going to lead by example, right, starting right with City Hall. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to reduce fuel consumption in city buildings, schools, city vehicles, and buses. We're going to conserve electricity. We're going to seek out and implement, to the fullest extent possible, alternative and renewable energy sources. We're going to institute planned and maintained harbor management. We are going to curb municipal pesticide use. We are going to implement organic and non-chemical cleaning protocols in our schools and in our city buildings. We're going to put recycling bins in more public places around the green, so when you have a soda or a bottle of water, you have a place to put it. We're going to refurbish our existing buildings to meet current environmental standards. The greenest building is the building we have before us. New buildings aren't green. Old buildings that we fix are green. And we're going to serve as an incubator for green technology. We're going to bring those people into Milford. We're going to refurbish our economy, and we're going to have a green environment. Being a green city means being green from top to bottom. It's a holistic, systemic approach. From the water on Long Island Sound to the top of Milford by Orange, we're going to green every part of our community. When we have open space like the Solomon property, we're not just going to acquire it. We're going to maintain it. We're going to keep it clean. We're going to keep it usable. That's being a green city. We're going to teach our children how to recycle. We're going to teach our children how important it is to take care of the environment, from the fish to the fauna. Everything is important. We are all global citizens, and it has to be a philosophy. It can't be a gimmick. It can't be something we do when it's convenient or on garbage pickup days. It has to be something that we incorporate into each and every of our daily lives, and we're going to start with the city government and lead by example. Thank you.
Tell me when I'm on, so I know.
Okay. All right. And I'd just like to remind the candidates that for the introduction, we didn't do a rebuttal, but everybody will have a whole 1 minute to rebut to the other candidates after the initial response.
Okay. All right, it's interesting when you hear people talk about green, because yes, we all love the color green, and green sounds good, but recently, when you look at some of our estuaries, they look awfully green, and an estuary shouldn't be green. It means an unusual amount of algae in the estuary. So it means that we're over-fertilizing our lawns and over-fertilizing our condominiums and that sort of thing. So you have to be a little careful. And sometimes when I see lawns that look unnaturally green, I say, oh my goodness. And then, of course, you see the little yellow pesticide and fertilizer sign. So you got to be careful when you talk about green. But several years ago, I decided that Milford had no nature center when I was chairing the Conservation Commission, and I said, this is kind of ridiculous. Kids from Milford have to go to Ansonia, an inland town, to learn about horseshoe crabs. So with Mayor Lisman, we got together city departments, and we recycled an old wastewater building at Gulf Pond. And that was back in 1990 that we got into the building. And so we've educated over 1,000 children at that facility in the last 20 years. And so that is what I mean by sincerity about being green and trying to educate the young children about our natural wonders in Milford. And Milford has many of them. Helen Langner, across the street, used to live here. And this used to be a marshland down behind the library here. I don't know if many of you knew that or not. But they filled in the marshes before Public Act 695 went in 1969. And today, it's a great recreational field. Now, I've heard some people say that we should really reestablish that marsh. I do not agree with that because it's a beautiful recreational complex that we have. My boys played ball there. In fact, before they played the games, they would stop at Helen Langner's house in their Little League uniforms, and then they'd go on and play. So there, you know, we have to balance human needs and recreation. This wonderful recreational complex is certainly one of them, with the environment. Now, there's many other things we could talk about. How much time do I have? I'm out. That's it.
This is fun. Yeah, let me begin by stating that responsible environmental advancement will be a priority during my term, but I want to make it very clear that any ongoing green will be tempered with what is cost-effective and affordable for the residents of Milford. That said, for Milford to be a true green city, I see five basic achievable goals that I will set forward when elected. First, I will implement proper recycling programs. Second, I will support environmentally friendly types of transportation. Third, I will support and encourage securing more open space. Fourth, I will encourage the building of green homes and offices. And fifth, I will lower the use of non-renewable resources. So how will I achieve these? I will first reduce our gas guzzler fleet and utilize hybrid or biofuel vehicles and encourage the use of mass transit by making it easier for residents to access such transport. Secondly, I will adopt the leadership in energy and environmental design for all city construction, and then phase it in for commercial construction within the next 2 years. Thirdly, I will have city energy audits done to ensure we are not wasting energy which wastes public money, and I would explore the use of eco-friendly energy sources. Fourthly, as previously stated in my campaign, I would buy as much open space as possible because once it's gone forever. The land sold behind the library is a sad example of that. And finally, I would modernize our recycling. Folks, these are not dreams that I just mentioned. These are all very real and achievable goals that many should have been implemented already, but sadly have not. But there is even more that can be done to make us what I call a pro-green city. To me, this means initiatives that keep us green well into the future. Initiatives like the Connecticut Clean Energy Options, where every 100 residents who sign up for clean energy, Milford gets a solar electric system. And an initiative like the Clean Renewable Energy Bonds, where Milford stands to receive very large tax credit from the federal government for projects generating clean energy, such as solar. Once installed, these initiatives will be with us for many, many generations to come. That's what I mean about keeping Milford green.
Thank you. Yes. keeping Milford green and making Milford greener, it's a priority that, you know, we hear the term green so much these days, but what does it mean? It means doing the things like being the third community in the state of Connecticut to take on the goal of 20% by 2010. That was making it a goal of the city, being the third municipality to do so, to commit to 20% of our energy sources coming from renewable clean energy sources. We took that on. We said we would do it by 2010. We did it in 2009. I didn't do that alone. I had a lot of help along the way. Along with that pledge came the Clean Energy Task Force. And we appointed the Clean Energy Task Force, and Chairman and many of you, Chairman Tom Ivers is here tonight. Many of you that are in the room are members of the Clean Energy Task Force. And you have set out a roadmap for clean energy in the city of Milford. And that will be our roadmap for the years to come. It spells out many different ways, performance enhancement contracts, where we look at our city buildings and our city fleet and looking how we can become more efficient, taking those benchmarks and then putting them into practice, taking advantage of state and federal grants that are available, like the $500,000 stimulus grant that Milford has received this year, and we will be utilizing over the next 6 months to a year to see where those benchmarks are and then to see how we can become more energy sufficient. We took on the goal of 20% by 2010. Our goal now, one of the goals of the Clean Energy Task Force and one of the goals adopted by the city, is to achieve 15% of the city's energy consumption to be saved by 2015 and 20% of our city's energy consumption to be saved by 2020. Those are achievable goals. The roadmap sets out the plan, and we will implement that plan. Thank you.
All right, 1 minute for rebuttal.
All of us have talked about goals. They're not goals, they're mandates. They're things we have to do to secure Milford's future. Just like we have to pave our roads, just like we have to make sure that our sewers work, we have to be good environmental stewards. We have to reduce our electric consumption. We have to recycle. We have to work on our buildings. We need solar power on our buildings. So I don't think that any of us will point fingers and say none of these ideas are lofty or important. They're all important. They're all integral. But we have to make sure that they don't simply become goals, but that they're mandates, that we strive to achieve them each and every day, and that they become part and parcel of city government in everything we do, from the rec department to the finance department. Everything we do has to be centered on being a greener city.
I've heard several of the candidates talk about putting recycling bins around the city and so that we do recycling. I've had more than one city official tell me that there are bins all over the Parsons, but apparently everything gets put into the same stream. So if that's happening, then there's some disconnect somewhere. And so it's one thing to talk about recycling at Parsons, it's something else to make sure that it's happening. And according to these city officials, these are prominent city officials, I'm not going to mention names, it's not happening at Parsons, I'm sorry to say.
And I don't know if mine is a rebuttal as much as when we're talking about the clean energy roadmap. This was something that was done by the Board of Aldermen, put into place back in 2005. And here we are in 2009, we're talking about 20% and all these grandiose numbers. And I think the report just came out that we're at 6% and one of the worst, if not the worst in the state. So again, to my point, it's been 6 years since this report has been out. And I am tired of doing reports for the sake of doing reports to tell people we're doing reports. A lot of good people in this room have done a lot of reports. We're still at 6%, people. That's terrible. That's just not fair or bad. It's horrible.
You know, this is going to be tough to do in 1 minute. Peter's just wrong on the facts. Respectfully, the report that came out, he said it came out 6 years ago. It's dated August 3rd, 2009, and it was presented to the Board of Aldermen at their September meeting. That's our energy roadmap that was presented to us by the Clean Energy Task Force. The 6% number, I will get into that the next question or the one after that. Milford, somewhere that number of 6% has come out, and that is just a wrong number. We have the report from DEP, we're at 9%. 9% is not good enough, but it's not 6%, and we're not nearly the worst in the state. Our figures, we worked with, we had discussions with DEP, and the numbers were incorrectly reported, and we're closer to 12% on that number. So we will get better with the help of the Recycling Committee of the ECC, and with the Smart Pate Save Money and Reduce Trash and Pay As You Throw committee, that's the advisory committee that's been set up, we will increase our recycling rate. I just want to correct those facts before we move on any further. Thank you.
All right, well, I assume that this is going to require some correction from some of the candidates as well, but the second question is that Milford has a recycling rate of about 6%, and this is one of the worst in Connecticut. During 2008, the average recycling rate in the state of Connecticut was between 25 and 26%. The DEP has set a target of 58% by the year 2024. What specific steps would you take to help the city of Milford achieve the current state average? And what would you do to achieve the target of 58 or to achieve better than the target?
Right. Well, first, this is the report from the CRRA. The numbers about our paltry recycling don't lie. I'm embarrassed by them, and I hope you're embarrassed by them. We can and should do better. What we're going to do under my leadership as mayor is we're going to incorporate the three R's. You kids in the audience, you've all heard about the three R's, right, from the Jack Johnson song? Reduce, reuse, recycle. We're going to educate The Clean Energy Task Force said, we don't have education here in Milford. Our citizens don't know what to do. We're going to educate our citizens on how to reduce, how to be conscious about packaging, how to be conscious about buying reusable coffee cups and reusable water bottles rather than styrofoam and plastic. So we're going to reduce. We're going to reuse. We are going to come together as a community to share, much like Nantucket does, much like other communities around the country do. We're going to share. If I have a dishwasher that I don't really like anymore, or I've got a new one, I'm going to put it in and let someone else take it. If I've got a deck that I'm not going to use anymore and I'm expanding my deck, we're going to put the wood out there and ask someone to take it. And maybe when I need something, maybe I need a new swing for the backyard for my son, I'm going to go to this exchange and find it. So we're going to reuse. And we are going to recycle. We don't recycle cardboard and cereal boxes. And do you know why? It's because of the contract. It's not because we can't. It's not because we're not allowed. It's because we haven't bothered in our contract. And I say we haven't, and I say we, I mean our city government, we haven't bothered. We are going to recycle cardboard, we are going to recycle boxboard, and we are going to implement single stream recycling to make it easier and cheaper for all of us to do the right thing for our community, for our environment, and for our planet.
Okay, the question was how do we, as mayor, encourage our residents to recycle more? Well, in Boston, Mayor Menino has literally given out thousands of compost bins to the residents of Boston. And so he's encouraged these residents to compost and thereby put less waste into the stream. Mayor Menino's become a great biker, so he goes all over the city and he sees things, and he has created a number of greenways. You know, I go all over the city. I don't see our city officials at the wild places, at the natural areas, and the salt marshes and so forth. I'm sure they do. I'm sure that Mr. Mayor does get out into those places. But when you do get out in those places, you see things like litter in certain areas. The southwest corner of Gulf Beach right now has a broken iron fence. It's been there for a long time, and it's unsightly, and there's litter in these areas. So you got to get out into the city. You got to see the things. You got to see sidewalks that people are literally tripping on, and such as on South Broad Street, for example. We could have a recycle corner at the transfer station, where if somebody has something that they don't want any longer, but they put it there, and then somebody else coming along might be able to take it. Now, I know you get into union issues that have to be a union man, public works person, making sure people don't cut themselves and so forth, but that is something that could be tried there. There could be city ordinances requiring. Remember a few years ago when we were all telling McDonald's to start using brown wrapping and instead of the plastics? You go to Boston Market and you see the plastics that they have at Boston Market. You want to take them home, wash them, and use them. They're so solid, and they just go into the incinerators and into the lungs that we all, the air that we all breathe. So there are lots of things that mayors can do. Of course, in our case, we recycled an old wastewater building. We should have recycled the buildings at Milford Academy. There were great buildings there. They would have made a great Milford Museum, but we didn't. We tore them right down. And even if the second and third floor were not safe and out of code, you could have shut off the second and third floor and used those wonderful buildings at Milford Academy. We didn't.
To put it bluntly, waste management in Milford is decades away from the 21st century. And it's an embarrassment, it's a hazard, it's inefficient, user-unfriendly, and ugly. As mayor, I will explore all avenues of household recycling to achieve better rates immediately. I will not be reactive, I will be proactive. My first step would be to implement a municipal campaign, a program of reduce, reuse, and recycle. Thank you, it was very nice. We already have state laws of what must be recycled.
I didn't know Genevieve made that up.
She did. I was looking over and I got it. Reduce, reuse, and recycle. You heard it here second. We already have state laws that must be recycled, but punitive laws and systems are not the answer. Governments must be facilitators, not watchdogs. I know that the ECC has looked extensively at the smart trash system, and that is a plan I would consider. I would also consider the single stream recycling plan that utilizes tote bins as well. My reasoning behind the single system is it is easier to use and would lend itself to a greater frequency of use by the consumer. It is more equitable and cost effective. Depending on the contractor we use, it could almost even be free. It reduces the need of trash bags, which are environmentally hazardous. it reduces manpower, and finally, it is less unsightly. The same method was used recently adopted by Stanford. In the first month alone, the volume of recycling increased by 47%, and trash was reduced by 28%. Those are some very impressive numbers. As a matter of fact, their rate was going from 10% in 2008 to a whopping 40% in 2020. And they also saved 15,000 right out of chute in the first year. I am certain that we in Milford can do as well, if not better, over the same period, and then we would be on our way to 58% well before the 2024 timeframe. And when elected as your mayor, I am ready, willing, and anxious to work with the ECC to ensure that whatever method we adopt, it will be the best for Milford, and I will commit to it to the fullest.
Thank you. Again, just to reiterate, and it doesn't really matter that Milford is not the worst, but our recycling rate is not 6%. Our recycling rate is 12%, and those numbers are verified by the DEP. We will get better at that. But throughout the course of my 8 years as mayor, I've worked with the ECC. I've worked with local organizations like the Milford Oyster Festival. I've worked with private industry, like Harry Garofalo, the owner of ShopRite, to bring in new, innovative recycling programs. I mentioned the Oyster Festival. 2 years ago, we worked with Harry Garofalo, and he donated through his grocery association, donated 50 recycling bins that were put out throughout our parks in the city. On Oyster Festival Day and other major events, they're all gathered back in and they're put down in the events, where the events are for recycling. We found that that's not working all that well. There's one small hole to put the bottles and cans in, and it's not working all that well. So this year, in working with the Oyster Festival, they came up with a new facility that is specifically for recycling, and it's worked very well. Working with our organizations like the Girl Scouts and the Boy Scouts for cleanup days and litter days and things like that, Milford can do better in its recycling. We will do better in our recycling, but to portray us as not environmentally friendly because of that just isn't the facts, and flies in the face of a lot of good people in a lot of different agencies, the ECC being one of them, the Open Space Committee, the Conservation Committee, the Clean Energy Task Force. All these groups come together, the PED committee, all these groups have come together to make our community a better community, a more environmentally friendly community, and one that we all can be proud of. Thank you.
1 minute for rebuttal.
Thank you. Connecticut has recycled cardboard and box board for 18 years. Since 1991, the Connecticut DEP gave us municipalities the authority and the ability to recycle cardboard and boxboard. I don't know about you, but I eat a lot of cereal. My son eats a lot of cereal, and I think we all probably buy shoes. So there's a lot of cardboard that we're putting in the garbage. And we put it in the garbage, we pay a tipping fee. And tipping fees are money. It's simple math. Less tipping fees, money savings. You know what? And the mayor's right. It's not the fault of the community. It's his fault. He's been a leader. He is supposed to lead us into the future. He is supposed to require us to do the right thing. He is supposed to make sure that our contracts do the right thing, to make sure that our contracts are as broad and as encompassing as they can be. So you're right, it's not the ECC's fault, it's not the community's fault, it's the failure of the administration to lead, and I don't think we want that anymore. Thank you.
Well, all I would reiterate is that apparently we have no recycling going on in the Parsons. The Parsons is a huge building, a very large building, and I don't know why it's not going on there. Maybe that mayor has an answer. I don't know.
Mine is just a simple one because I was told that I was given the wrong numbers, and I don't want you to think that I'm given the wrong numbers. But I'm looking at a report that specifically says the Milford Board of Aldermen opened the year 2005 by adopting this forward-looking resolution. Milford commits to making at least 20% of the municipal purchases come from clean energy sources by the year 2010. 2010 is 2 months away from now, and whether it's 6% or 9%, we're nowhere near 20% in the past 8 years. And this is the number and the date that I'm talking about.
Friends, just to be clear, the report that Peter's referring to was the report that came out that said that we committed to the goal of 20% by 2010. That was 5 years ago, and our goal was to do it by 2010. We beat that by 6 months and did it in 2009 with the help of a lot of people in our community. Second thing is, I wish that I had as much authority as Mrs. Salvatore says that the mayor should have, because it just doesn't happen. The city of Milford entered into 20 years ago an agreement to convert our trash to energy at the Bridgeport plant. Prior to that, we all know that there was a dump at Silver Sand State Park. It was a landfill. The goal was to do away with landfills, and so we started bringing our trash, along with a consortium of 19 other towns, to the trash to energy plant in Bridgeport, making trash into electricity. We had a 20-year agreement. That agreement ended in January. I worked with the mayors and first selectmen of those 19 towns over a 2-year period to come up with a new plan which doesn't bind us to a certain percentage of trash that we needed to send to the burn plant. With that minimum tonnage guarantee out of the contract, we can now concentrate on doing other things with recycling, and we can increase our recycling. That's the authority that the mayor has to work with in a cooperative way with the other mayors and first selectmen, with the DEP and other groups, to make sure that in the future we do things better.
Okay, the next question. On September 14th, 2009, the Board of Aldermen accepted the Milford Clean Energy Task Force's roadmap, which is part of the Comprehensive Energy Plan for the city. The roadmap recommends 2 organizational changes within the city to implement this plan, and also a change in the budget process as part of that. Are you prepared as mayor to support these changes, and why or why not?
Thank you. First, I want to applaud the efforts of the Clean Energy Task Force. It was truly a task force, and it represented all members of the community in all different disciplines. So I want to thank you. However, the report, if you review the report, the difficulty of the task that they had is demonstrated. At its heart, the Clean Energy Roadmap is an indictment of the current administration. Because Milford lacks a plan, our outdated city buildings, lack of energy consumption monitoring, and poor energy management, we have been left at a disadvantage. Luckily, the roadmap provides just that. A roadmap to a greener future if we're willing to take it. Now, most of us care about the health of our community. However, even if we're not environmentalists, even if we don't consider ourselves green, we all care about money. And I just want to give you some simple facts. This is from the report. Merely by reducing our energy consumption by 10%, we can save nearly $600,000 per year in our municipal energy costs. Now, the annual budget rate for our municipal energy costs is $4.2 million. So, $600,000 of $4.2 million is a 14% annual decrease in just the costs associated with energy. That makes sense, and it's more than a 100% return on our investment for reducing costs, or reducing consumption by 10%. The roadmap calls to attention the fact that our city budget is not transparent with respect to energy consumption costs. City departments are merely given a line item for energy costs, and they're not tied to consumption. They're not tied to kilowatt hours. They're not tied to the usage. The roadmap calls for a change in the way we budget to better identify and link the consumption of costs, and I wholeheartedly adopt that because it goes right in line with my zero-based budget philosophy of accounting for every dollar and making sure every dollar makes sense, both for our services and for our environment. I intend to implement that as well as the energy management team so that we can keep a better eye on what we're doing and have a roadmap for the future. Thank you.
Okay, well, the good news is that Milford has achieved the 20% by 2010 in electricity. So Milford, there's 545 points that have been gained, and it's largely Milford people that have been doing this, so that's the good news. Now, there are other objectives, 15% by 2015 and 20% by 2020 of just general energy consumption, not electricity, which is what I was just talking about. And so that's a goal of the task force, Incidentally, there were some incredible people on the task force, people like Barbara Bell on the Siting Council, Sly Moore, a very conscientious person in public works. And so the trick is to find out how you can make the department heads at various buildings, the library, for example, know how much energy they're consuming. Currently, they just don't know. It's all done through public works, so they simply don't know how much they're consuming. When asked if they would make changes, if they could control the energy, many of the department heads, I have been told, said yes, they would love to know how much energy they're actually consuming. So that is a benchmark where you have to start. And the next thing would be to turn the task force into the energy management team, and they would become a new body and an advisory group for the mayor, and in helping to carry the clean energy roadmap into the future. So that would be the second thing that would have to be done. And then, of course, there's the they have to change the process for budgeting energy expense, recording and distributing cost and consumption data. That's a difficult task. There's an EPA model that they have thought about doing. There has to be auditing that has to take place. It will not be easy, and they targeted November of 2009 as a target. Is this realistic? It may be a little bit overly ambitious, but certainly the roadmap should be followed. Thank you. And thanks to all the people that worked on it.
I read the roadmap, and overall it was really outstanding, and the group did an awesome job. To the question at hand, though, yes, I would support the two operational and budgetary changes, albeit with some modifications. I believe the formation of an energy management team is imperative. Milford's energy budget for 2009-2010 is over $4 million, and just the size of that warrants oversight, and that must rest in the hands of the dedicated specialists. I would develop a close working relationship between the mayor's office and the energy management team and city department heads to ensure that we all are working on the same goals. I also favor the modification of the budget process to better budget and record energy costs and consumption. This information will enable the energy management team to undertake different strategies. Energy expenditure should be treated the same as other city expenditures and not as some incidental cost of running the city. Under my leadership as mayor, I will make sure that I know why and where we are spending more than $4 million on energy and where we could reduce that cost. To put it in perspective, in order for the mayor to announce that we were going to get a reduction in our taxes, he asked the unions to freeze their pay raises, essentially, to raise their over $800,000 in the city budget. If we could just save 20% of our energy expenses, it would give us back the $800,000 without having to increase taxes to do so. It's a win-win scenario. The other issue raised by the report is the information of an energy advisory board, which is basically an evolution of the current Milford Clean Energy Task Force. This proposal is to enable them to assist the energy management team implement the initiatives contained in the report. I am not sold on the idea that an additional board is required, adding yet another reporting layer. Certainly after the good work of the task force, I would want them to keep their expertise on hand, and I would like to include them on the energy management team as well. As part of that team, the task force could deal directly with the issues rather than having a separate reporting structure that could get in way of fast and decisive action.
Thank you. Once again, I, as we all have, I want to thank the members of the Clean Energy Task Force for their roadmap to our energy policy in the city of Milford, which we have officially adopted. The simple answer to the question, would I accept the recommendation of the Clean Energy Task Force? Yes. The answer is very simply yes. An energy management team made up of the departments in the city that consume the energy, that know where the dollars are going, is essential. And we've already started the rudiments of that. The second one is making the Clean Energy Task Force the energy advisory board of the city. And that's a no-brainer. This group of individuals is a talented group of people who have worked tirelessly as volunteers to come up with the clean energy roadmap that we have in front of us. And so making them the advisory board of the city is really no brainer. And in fact, de facto, that's how they have been functioning over the past 3 or 4 years that they've been in existence. Concrete examples of things that we've put into place. As we all know, we received a $500,000 community development block grant for energy conservation projects. As part of that project, I've upgraded Tom Iver's position slightly so that his new job function is specifically to administer the energy grant. And that's an important thing for us moving forward. Mrs. Salvatore talked about energy being dollars, and it absolutely is. And since I've been mayor, we've looked at performance enhancement contracts. We've implemented one at our police department and our fire department, and have saved over $75,000 per year in those buildings as a result of installing new energy efficient products. We entered the United Illuminating Company's energy curtailment program. And during the course of the 3 years that we've been involved in that, we've saved over $200,000 for the city of Milford. And the last one that I just want to mention, and I'll talk about after, is we just received a check for $409,000. And that was as a result of energy efficient equipment that was incorporated into the new sewer treatment plant upgrades that were done as part of our need to be responsible in clean water on Long Island Sound. But energy efficiency led to $409,000 in incentive payments coming back to the city. That's energy saved, and it's real dollars.
Okay, 1 minute for rebuttal.
Thank you. You know, going through this roadmap, one of the most important details is a plan, or Milford's lack of a plan. And you just heard Jim Riccitelli tell you about the couple of things we've been able to do, some of it by accident, but because we have a bad economy. Because we have a bad economy, we get stimulus money and we can get something done. But it shouldn't be that way. It should be that we have a plan for energy efficiency, consumption, and the use of renewable resources as a daily practice. Again, not something we do haphazardly, not something we do because we're lucky enough to get a grant, but something that we do as a daily practice in city government. That's what the study calls for. That's what the energy management team will do. I think the energy management team is not another level of bureaucracy. I think it's very important because they're experts. If you need an expert in a field, you go to that expert. And without experts, we're going to flounder. We're not going to have a plan, and we're not going to be successful. So I adopt wholeheartedly the recommendation of the energy management team.
Yeah, it is a no-brainer. The energy management team are qualified people. They've drawn up an excellent roadmap. There's no question they should continue. The question is, who will guide them? Will it be Mr. Ivers, or could it be a political appointee? And I certainly would hope it would not be a political appointee, that it'll be somebody with expertise like Mr. Ivers, who would guide the energy management team. He has guided it to this point, presumably. And so that is important. And the question of the block grant and the money, why haven't we been getting block grant money right along for the past 8 years to improve our energy efficiency at the various buildings in Milford? Thank you.
And again, so I'm not assuming, and so I'm not just throwing out numbers. Let me just read you from the report. While electricity usage had grown at different rates in recent years, the top three electricity users have consistently been the public schools, wastewater treatment, and the municipal buildings. Yet the plan goes on to talk about, while the BOE has reliable consolidated figures of heating and cooling consumption for its facilities, including 205, 207, the DPW either does not have records or was unable to make them available. That's unacceptable. This is a city. None of you out there in your job could tell your boss that you don't have records of any sort for something that you had to do and produce. The records have got to be there somewhere. Somebody's got to be able to tell us what's going on in not just the DPW, but in any and every department that we're working with. This group has done an awesome job. We've said that. It's nothing to do with the group. It's the folks that are out there and turning in the information. This is the stuff that needs management, follow up, and follow through. And as mayor, you'll get follow up and follow through.
Just to follow up a little bit further on energy consumption and energy savings, in 2007, we saw that the energy market was favorable, and we were paying exorbitant rates to UI, higher than we needed to pay. So we joined at that time the Connecticut Conference of Municipalities Energy Consortium. And as a result of that, we went out to bid. We no longer buy our electricity from UI. We buy it from a bid through a bid process, and the winning bid was a company called TransCanada. And we've saved over $508,000 since 2007 when we entered that program. Just last week, we went out to bid again through the consortium. And we, through that, we were able to save more money on our electric bill, and we'll be saving an additional, over the course of the contract, $375,000 more. Over $870,000 in energy savings. Last thing I want to say, because before we leave this question, is one of the recommendations of the Clean Energy Task Force has been fuel cells. And we are planning a fuel cell at our wastewater treatment facility at Housatonic. There are many incentives that the state will grant us, and we will invest city money. We'll use the methane gas from the plant to fuel the fuel cell, and we should be able to generate enough electricity to pay for the majority of the electric use at that wastewater treatment facility, which is our largest number one electric user in the city of Milford. That's real planning, that's real dollars, that's real energy consumption.
All right, we're just going to take a minute so public access can change the tape, so residents watching this at home get to see the full debate here, so just take a minute for that.